Hi everyone, my name is Theodor Mitev, and in this lecture titled Emergent Media, we will discuss Henry Jenkins's definition of the process of convergence and its implications. Reminder that this lecture builds on a previous lecture in which we discussed various definitions of the media and the various definitions of the process of communication, while focusing on Marshall McLuhan's definition of media as extensions of ourselves and his famous dictum, the media is the message. In this lecture, we will focus specifically on the way the process of convergence, as described by Henry Jenkins, leads to emergent media formats involving new platforms, new types of audience behavior, and new media industries. All right, so as a starting point, let's have this quite elegant, I should say, definition of the process of convergence by Henry Jenkins from his article Worship the Author of Convergence. And Jenkins describes convergence as the flow of content across multiple media platforms, the cooperation between multiple media industries, and the migratory behavior of media audiences. So this is quite a complex statement, and you may or may not agree with it in its entirety, and we will be problematizing it down the track in this series of lectures. What is important for our purposes is that Jenkins has attempted to identify three distinct vectors which are in a process of constant interplay with each other as part of a larger process, the process which he terms as convergence. And these vectors are first this notion of media platforms, which is quite specific in the way Jenkins uses it, and it stands for everything from various technologies which can carry content to platforms such as, for example, YouTube. And this notion of media platforms in the context of the process of convergence, according to Jenkins, should be understood in terms of the flow of content across them. And this is a really important insight because, as we will see down the track in this lecture, there are profound and disruptive implications associated with the flow of content across media platforms, as opposed to content being locked down and pertaining to only one media platform, right? Remember, we are building on our analysis of media in the context of Marshall McLuhan's dictum here. Also, the second vector is cooperation between media industries. So you have a sort of interaction and cooperation between industries as a reaction to the flow of content across multiple media platforms, presumably owned by media industries, but also as a reaction to the third vector, which is the migratory behavior of media audiences. So this is an interesting choice of words, migratory behavior. Why migratory? Because audiences, according to Jenkins, in the process of the larger process of convergence, audiences are not tied to one specific channel, to one specific platform anymore. They are not beholden to one specific media industry, right? They can and in fact do migrate between industries and between platforms. What is more, they do not act as the audiences of old anymore, right? So this is a very complex, very dense statement. So, and for the remainder of this lecture, we'll be unpacking it and trying to understand how its implications actually work in practice, using our notion of emergent media as a kind of carry-all term which describes this process. Okay, so here we have these three vectors. We have the notion of media platforms, technologies. We have the notion of industries and audiences. And the interplay of these three forces, of these three vectors, frames the entire relationship and within the process of convergence as described by Henry Jenkins. So let's go one by one now and analyze each of these vectors. So starting with technologies. slash media platforms. And the first and most important realization associated with that definition of flow of content across multiple media platforms, and this is, remember, this is a point that Henry Jenkins makes in that piece, is that it is associated with and the result of a shift from analog to digital content, right? A shift from content appearing on analog platforms, and you could give a multitude of examples of analog platforms, such as newspapers or cassette tapes, for that matter, or vinyls, etc., etc. So these are platforms which tie the content encoded on them in a specific format to a specific channel, to that specific platform. That content cannot easily migrate without a fundamental massive transformation, right? From that platform to another platform. And this is a really important realization, because until the arrival of digital media as a phenomenon and the concomitant arrival of the internet, there was no way where content could travel freely across platforms, right? So this kind of a transformation of content from one platform to another was first and foremost heavily negotiated between industries. It was a controlled transformation, and it was always a transformation, right? It involved a complete change in the type of the way the content was presented, because this was analog content, right, tied to a specific platform. Not so with the appearance of digital media, not so with the appearance of the internet, where content can travel freely between your phone and your computer and projecting that same content on the screen and maybe speakers in your car, etc., etc., etc. And it's the same content. It does not undergo transformation. The medium changes, right? And this is an interesting problematization of our discussion in the context of the previous lecture of the definition of media by Marshall McLuhan. So we have the flow of content across platforms, right, which completely changes the relationship between content, so the information, and its encoding platform and its channel or the technology that carries it, on the one hand, and the relationship between those platforms and the larger process of convergence the other two vectors, audiences and industries, that we already mentioned. So the result here is that these flows are unpredictable, right? They are not anymore entirely under the control of the content industries. And when we talk down the track in the cycle of lectures about copyright, we will see clearly how the industry, the content industry, is trying to use copyright as a control mechanism to limit and often prevent completely the flow of content across platforms, which is made possible by the emergence of digital media, right, and by the larger process of convergence. So in that context, the content industry is in a reactionary mode to the challenge, the disruptive challenge posed to it by convergence and by the affordances of the process of convergence and the digitization of media. So far we can make a certain observation, which is that convergence appears in the context of the free flow of content between various platforms is a non-linear process, a process with unpredictable results that cannot be controlled or planned for, right? Think of the emergence of dramatically new apps on smartphones and the flow of content between those apps and more established platforms. This is a bi-directional and often multi-directional flow of content, which disrupts the more established platforms. And this is a continuous process of convergence of platforms and new types of content, new types of audiences, new types of industries, right? It's an unpredictable process, hence non-linear. It cannot be easily planned for and charted. All right, so we've kind of mapped one of the three vectors, platforms. Now let's look at audiences. Remember in the definition provided to us by Henry Jenkins, audiences are described as having what he frames as migratory behavior, right? Which is an interesting concept. So from the perspective of convergence, we have an interesting shift here, which can be observed at a macro level. Audiences stop being framed entirely as passive consumers. So think in terms of analog media, such as television or radio or newspapers, and the relationship of the audience to this media, the way these media frame the audience, the affordances they provide to the audience, right? These are, the audience is framed in a very specific passive state of consumption, right? So this is a contentious statement, of course, because you could make all sorts of arguments about the active role of the audience in television, but at the macro level, the audience is inarguably, I would say, framed as a passive consumer of content, right? Even though at times it can speak back to the originators, to the producers and distributors of this content, both in terms of its direct reaction to the content and in terms of, for example, the direction of its attention. But these are, you could say, second order feedback effects from the audience. The audience as such is not active in the production, in the distribution, and in the way that content is appearing, right? It's for intents and purposes framed in a completely passive way as consumers of content. So we're talking about the analog form of content distribution, about analog media. But once we start observing the appearance of digital media and that shift in towards a new form of messages, and remember, I want to remind you of McLuhan's dictum, right? New types of media result in a change of scale, change of pace, change of patterns of behavior, right? The media as extensions of ourselves. So, in effect, new types of thinking, new types of being. So, the change into digital media formats and the resultant change, as we already described, from analog to digital platforms and the flow of content across platforms has profound effects on audiences. Why? Because audiences suddenly can act in a much more active way with regards to both platforms and content. Audiences can act as makers, right? Think of the practically infinite forms of active making that the internet allows, right? Active production of all sorts of different content, sharing of all sorts of different content, the curation of all sorts of different content, the participation is in all sorts of different communities emergent around these new types of content, right? So we have a shift from audiences as passive consumers to audiences as active makers or users or participants or curators, etc., etc., etc. This is the dynamic with regards to the audience vector in the larger process of convergence. And if you frame it in terms of content, you have a paradigm shift, literally, from only consuming content to consuming, yes, but also producing and also sharing and also even curating content. Right? So think in terms of, your favorite Netflix show and the way. If Netflix was an analog TV channel, you would be consuming this show passively, and your role as an audience member would pretty much be encapsulated by that experience, right? Your experience of consuming it, consuming the show. Whereas in a present paradigm, right, the paradigm of convergence, if you want to describe it that way, of emergent media, while watching the show, you can simultaneously share your experiences across a number of social media of the process of watching the show. You can share those experiences with a global audience, which participates in that process simultaneously with you, right, or asynchronously with you, you could produce your own variations, remixes of this, of whatever content you're producing. You know, you could, this could be a small memes, it could be GIFs, or it could be remixes, or fan fiction remixes, or whatever you want to call them. This could be your own remixes on YouTube. So you could simultaneously, while consuming that content, also act as a curator of streams of new types of content emerging from it, and as the audience member, not an audience member anymore, actually, you are a community member in the, an emergent community around this new type of content. And also you're a producer of new type of content associated with it, right? So that role has morphed spectacularly with the shift from analog to digital, and with the shift from passive to active audiences. So again, media as product on the one end, in a legacy media format, in a legacy media paradigm, the media packaged as product has as its only affordance an act of consumption. So as an audience member, you are left with the option of consuming that product, right? And at best interacting with it in your role as a consumer, right? Whereas after that shift, and in the process of convergence, media stops being in so much as stops being a closed product, stops being an object which you can interact with as a surface, but it becomes an open process. It becomes more like a conversation as opposed to a more like a product, right? So you can enter at that, at a specific media from any point, right? You can consume it as a whole. Sure, you can still pretend that you are a passive consumer, but you can also enter it at any point as if it were a conversation, and you can start adding to it, annotating it, you can start aggregating different bits and pieces, you can start curating it, creating new conversations around it, new communities around it, etc., etc., etc. So you have a shift from media as product to media as conversation. And this shift appears, notice we are still at describing where only two of the three vectors participating in the process of convergence. So we have described media platforms, and we've described the migratory behavior of audiences. So what's fascinating that only at this stage already we can observe that there's a dramatic shift, there's a dramatic difference between the situation before the emergence of digital media and convergence, and where we are now. All right, so even though in Jenkins's definition, industries precede audiences, I've chosen to organize that relationship differently in order to illustrate how profoundly disruptive this process, the process of convergence, has been for the content industries. Because they are the third vector in convergence, the process of convergence as described by Jenkins. So from their perspective, if you were to put yourself in the shoes of a media executive in a large media company, whether that is a legacy media company like a TV station, or whether that is a you know, new media company, I don't know, let's say a gaming company, or whatever media company you can think of, the primal and key challenge here is how to manage and control the flow of content. Given, and again, a reminder, given that we are observing a process which consists of the flow of content across platforms, unimpeded, right? Unless there is a specific concentrated effort to impede it, and the migratory behavior of audiences which have stopped acting as passive consumers. They are more and more self-consciously acting in completely new and unpredictable ways as producers, aggregators, curators, sharers, etc., etc. So how to manage that non-linear flow of content while retaining one's business model? This has been the dramatic challenge for the content industry. Specifically, because the traditional content industry, what we call legacy media, has organized itself, and its business model has always been framed around a control of channels, right? So you control a specific newspaper. This is your channel, right? And all the content that appears there is controlled by you, right? You might amass a number of newspapers, and then you control all of those as independent channels. So content can flow between them, but it's entirely at your mercy, right? You can declare that content should not be flowing between these two channels, and it stops, right? So this is the nature of analog media channels. And the entire business model was built around that. So you have an example of TV companies or Hollywood as such in its entirety, controlling how content, movies or TV series, appears across different channels in cinemas or in televisions, right? And preventing the flow of content between, the uncontrolled flow of content across those channels. Because your entire business model has been organized around monetizing specific channels for targeted at specific audiences and intended to contain specific content, again, controlled by you. Right, so we have the challenge here is that with the process of convergence appearing and intensifying, we have, if you are from the looking at this from the perspective of the content industry, we have first the flow of content, which is becoming unpredictable and uncontrollable, and we have the fact that it happens across platforms, which in your legacy model were controlled by you. And you might still retain control over them, but the content flows in ways which you cannot predict, right? And finally, audiences stop acting as passive consumers, or in the words of Professor Jay Rosen from New York University, the people formerly known as the audience, right? So these are the people who are now acting different. They've stopped being passive consumers. They are much more than that now. Right, hence uncontrollable, hence unpredictable. And the challenge here is control, maintaining a business model and a viable long-term for those industries. And this is a challenge which, as you will discover in this lecture series, has been profoundly disruptive for the media industry and profoundly disruptive for the news industry and for the practice of journalism and for literally all legacy media. And they've all tried to tackle this challenge in one way or another with more or less success, as we'll discover. All right, so let's try and understand this challenge. Let's try and understand this process from the perspective of content, because this is probably the one unifying element which flows across these three vectors that we've identified in the process of convergence. So content flows across media platforms. It involves media audiences, the people formerly known as the audience, in all of their new and interesting and strange capacities as producers, consumers, sharers, curators, aggregators, etc. And the industry, which is trying to control this process, trying to react to it and survive, right? So let's look at what happens to media content. What are the dynamics involved here? So the first thing we need to take into account when it comes to content is that it is involved with scarcity. Media content is rare, and this I realize this is a profoundly counterintuitive observation, because we are drowning in content on the internet, which is an important qualification in its own right. But media content is rare. Why? Because someone has to make it, right? If no one makes content, there won't be any content flowing across platforms. And making content has always, and particularly in the legacy media platform, been associated with cost. And this cost, the cost of making, has its own set of undeniable affordances and acts as a formatting element for content. So in the context of this lecture, we're looking at this as the formatting row of cost. So if we break down the formatting row of cost, when it comes to the production of content, we have first the element of production. Someone has to make that video, or someone has to write that book, or someone has to record this podcast, or someone has to make this film, etc., etc. There is also the risk of failure, right? So if someone writes a book, presumably they've spent an X amount of time and effort to make that book, and then you know, someone else has been printing that book, so there is a cost in the production itself, not only in terms of writing the book, but also in terms of printing it. And then there is a cost associated with the distribution of that book to a wider audience, right? And when you look at it that way, you realize that there is a risk of failure associated with the entire process, because if no one wants to read the book and no one wants to buy it, then all of these costs are negative, right? Neither the author nor the distributor will recoup their losses, both in terms of time and in terms of effort and raw cost in production and distribution. There is also cost associated with the consumption of content, both in terms of time and, again, the raw numerical value of buying that book. So cost acts across the entire process, from the moment of the production of the book, the writing of it, through its distribution to an audience, to the audience actually purchasing and interacting with that content. So cost acts in a way which formats the content across the entire process. In effect, cost acts as a filter for content, right? It is the primary and first, the fundamental filter for content. So this filter acts both in terms of quality, like think in terms of the book, right? You have an author with a manuscript, which the author has written at great personal expense, presumably both in terms of time and effort. So the author brings this manuscript to a publisher. The publisher immediately imposes a quality control filter because of cost, right? We already mentioned that. So there is a quality control filter in terms of, you know, is this book good enough so that others may want to read it? Not only that, though, there is also a distribution limit, because let's say the publisher decides that, you know, this book is good enough, others may want to read it. But even if the publisher has the best possible intentions when it comes to the distribution of that book, they will not be able to print infinite amount of copies, right? There is always a distribution limit. There is always a max printing number of books. So cost here acts as a filter, both in terms of the quality of the product, both in terms of the quality of the content, and in terms of the number of pieces of content that are going to be distributed to a potential audience, right? So cost acts as a natural limitation for content. And this is axiomatic. So this applies to each and every type of content in a legacy media format. So the cost of production of content, in effect, the cost of quality, the quality filter that we already mentioned, and the distribution cost associated with bringing that content to a mass audience, act as filters. So not everyone can be a book publisher. Not everyone can have their own radio station. Not everyone can start their own TV company, etc., etc. So in effect, in aggregate, over time, the formatting row of cost ends up producing a concentration of ownership when it comes to the distribution of content, the production and the distribution and the quality control over content. And this, in effect, is what we call the content industry, right? This is why we don't have 10,000 or 100,000 or whatever number you can think of Hollywood studios. We have a small number, right? This is why we have a dramatic concentration in the ownership of newspapers, in the ownership of TV stations, magazines, book publishers, etc., etc., right? Because of the formatting role of the cost. And this cost is the cost of production, the cost of quality control, the cost of distribution. And this is, in effect, the inescapable affordance of the legacy media, right? Analog media, as we also call them, using the definition that Jenkins has provided. So, cost access filter, right? In the context of content in the legacy media paradigm. Let's analyze this even further. Let's look at the printed book, right? Let's look at the printed book and trace its production and try and understand what is so disruptive about convergence here. So first, you have a cost of entry, which is the high cost of production, right? So not everyone can publish. Even if everyone, presumably in our imaginary universe, everyone wants to be an author, but not everyone can publish, right? Because there's only so many publishers and there is a cost associated with printing a book and distributing. So you have a cost of entry associated with that. You have a high risk of failure because not every book will be as popular with the potential audience. And so publishers have to be very conscientious in the way they choose the filter that they deploy in picking authors, in picking books that they will be distributing, right? So the risk of failure itself acts as a filter on content. And again, reminder, I am describing here what we've termed variably as the legacy media model or as analog media, right? There is a very high risk of failure associated with both the cost of entry in terms of content and the distribution of this type of content. There is also a high cost of consumption, however, because these two previous costs compounded give us a very high cost of books, right? Compared to what comes next, they give us the very high cost of accessing that content. Right, if you are the audience for that specific book. And finally, we already mentioned that there is a quality filter as an effect because these different costs access natural filters and limitations on first the raw amount of content that can be distributed in this way and the type of content that becomes accessible. So you automatically have all sorts of filters, editorial filters being deployed before we even bring in taste and fashion and things like that into the equation. So to reassess, we have substantial costs associated with the entire process, starting from the production of content to the distribution of content and its consumption. So this is the paradigm within which the content industry, as we know it today, was formed, right? The paradigm within which it emerged over the last 200 years, we could say, in broad terms, with the arrival of the Industrial Revolution, the arrival of the masses. We already talked about this in the previous lecture on Marshall McLuhan and in the examples we discussed with the radio. This is the paradigm of legacy media in general and the content industry in particular as we know it today. Now, let's contrast this with the internet. In order to understand that shift, in order to understand the dynamics which the content industry is facing and the dynamics which have reformatted how platforms operate and how audiences see themselves and enact themselves from moment to moment in the process of convergence. So there are so many different ways to describe the internet, but for our purposes, what's interesting is the fact that anyone can contribute anything at any point on a vast array of platforms, right? And that content, that contribution is immediately portable, right? So that content can flow across without any limitation, right? So this is really important because it strikes at the crux of the issue here, right? The notion of cost that we identified. So let's unpack this. First, the cost of entry, in contrast to the previous paradigm, which we already described, the cost of entry is practically zero for intensive purposes, right? It's a very low cost of production. And so when you think about this, think in terms of your cost of producing and posting online a YouTube video or posting online a podcast on SoundCloud or posting a meme, or posting a GIF or posting a something on a blog, right? A piece of text. Think in these terms. What are the costs of doing that in terms of a quality filter, in terms of production, in terms of distribution? As a result, there is practically a non-existent risk of failure because of the low cost of production. You do not have the expectation, the production, distribution, and overall appearance of that content online. You do not have the high risks associated with failure, which we encountered with the old paradigm. So there is a very low risk of failure as a result. And we, in fact, find ourselves in a position where we have to redefine failure, because is a video which appears now on YouTube and has maybe 10 views, is it a failure? In the context of the legacy media, yes, it is. It's an automatic failure. It should be taken down because it wastes valuable space. But in the context of the internet, of this new emergent media paradigm, it is not a failure because down the track, it might suddenly become popular. Down the track, maybe in a week, maybe in a month, maybe in a year, or even longer, this video might suddenly jump into prominence. Why? Because it is available. It is accessible to a global audience, right? And it's a type of content that can flow across all sorts of different platforms, can be accessible from across all sorts of different platforms. And is subject, therefore, to the migratory behavior of global audiences. Hence, very low risk of failure. Which automatically brings me to that point, and this should be obvious by now. There is a low to zero cost of consumption, which is concomitant with the low to zero cost of production, right? So you can access all of that content which has been brought online without any effort, right? And this is a very obvious, very trivial observation in the year 2020, but it was only 20 years ago, it was still kind of radical, and maybe 30 or 40 years ago, it was revolutionary, right? Barely thinkable in the context of analog media. So as a result of all of this, the low cost of low to zero cost of production, low to zero cost of consumption, we have a complete absence of a quality filter is an effect, right? If you want to post something online, whatever that something is, and you have here an almost infinite spectrum of possible types of content that you want to share with the global audience, you can, right? You can pick a platform, and remember, content, this is digital content which flows across platforms and is subject to the migratory behavior of global audiences, right? So as a result, there is no quality filter whatsoever. And so let's start reassessing this at a macro level and comparing to the previous paradigm. We have content production and distribution costs in the legacy paradigm. These costs acting as filters. We have scarcity, we have concentration of ownership, and a very high quality filter. By quality, I don't mean that all the content was of absurdly high value, but that most of the content submitted was rejected, right? Because of the limitations that we already described. Whereas here we have content production and distribution costs which are minimal, right? And an absence of a filter. We have consumption costs being zero. And this is, by contrast, the internet paradigm. And this is the great disruptive power of emergent media. It's encapsulated in this realization of the dramatic shift when it comes to the arrival of the internet. Suddenly, the role of the industry, of the content industry, of what we term sometimes as legacy media, is under all-out attack by the first the shifting migratory behaviors of the people formerly known as the audience, and the uncontrolled flow of dramatically increasing in its amount content across media platforms, uncontrollable content, right? And all of this is brought about because of the fundamental shift in media, right? And this is, again, I recall for you the notion of media as encapsulated by McLuhan's dictum, the medium is the message, right? We have a change in media, we have a change in messages, we have a change in scale and pace and patterns of behavior, right? Media as extensions of ourselves. A change in media results in changes of in being, right? So what we're describing here as emergent media, in effect, is a dramatically new type of being, dramatically new paradigm for media. And this paradigm was described in this also a quite paradoxical statement by Stuart Brand, so he's a legendary media theorist, who was one of the founders of the Howard catalog, and he was associated with the internet from its appearance and its very beginnings in the early 90s. So what Stuart Brand says here is that in this paradoxical statement, information wants to be free, but it also wants to be expensive. So if we parse this in the context of what we've described and problematized so far in this lecture, we have very interesting results, because information wants to be free maps very nicely to the notion of content flowing across platforms, unimpeded, breaking down the barriers of control erected around it by the content industry. But information also wants to be expensive. And this is really interesting. This is one of the great dramatic tensions in this new paradigm of emergent media we're trying to describe and map here, because while information flows dramatically, there is also it flows dramatically across platforms and is disruptive, hence the notion of the dramatic element associated with information and content. There is also no content, no quality for no filter for quality. There is also no filter when it comes to the raw production, uploading and sharing of information. And the result is that we're drowning in an avalanche of new content, which is continuously produced and shared, flowing across all sorts of different platforms. As a result, finding a specific, important, relevant piece of information becomes harder and harder. So information is such wants to be free, it flows freely across, but it's also expensive, because finding that specific piece of information that is relevant to a specific situation, to a specific context, to a specific query, if you will, is tremendously valuable, right? Hence, in this context, the value of companies like Google, right? Why? Because of the act as intermediaries in the process of identifying and finding information. All right. So let's stop here. Thank you all for listening, and see you online.